Hey guys, what's up? It's RJ with Road to Liberty. Today is Tuesday. It's about 3 in the morning. I'm in Chicago right now, actually heading back to the East Coast. Stay tuned for more updates on what my plans are there. But in the meantime, I have a special interview for you guys today with none other than Nick Hazelton of the anarcho-capitalist podcast and the Freedom Feens. I want you guys to try to enjoy the interview with Nick Hazelton. He is a up-and-coming liberty personality who does some stuff on the Freedom Feens. He's a co-host on that program, and he has his own podcast. He's also a yak farmer and a high school dropout, but not in the sense where it's a bad thing, in the sense where he did it on purpose. So anyway, without any further
The TSA
chit
has
chat, you guys
terminated the
enjoy the
virus
video
sending the
and
carrier through a screening
let me know what you
checkpoint.
think. Hey guys, what's up? It's RJ, Road to Liberty, here on a Google Hangout with none other than Mr. Nick Hazelton, the anarcho-yacatalist of the Freedom Fiends of the anarcho-yacatalist podcast. Is that the correct?
Yeah,
Why don't
it's
you
the
tell everyone the name of your online headquarters?
Yeah, I have the anarcho-yacatalism podcast. You can find it at an-yak.com, an-yak.com, and we're on iTunes, Stitcher, and TuneIn.
Cool. All right. Froze up a little bit for me on my side, but hopefully I didn't interrupt too bad.
Okay.
To give the audience a little catch up, most of you guys actually might have seen another video. I'm currently crashing in the camper scene right now. Give you guys a little peek out into the backyard, maybe if you can get the focus going. Not really. Just looks like I'm on the sun. While I bring up my notes, oh shoot. Nick, why don't you tell the fine folks what you did with yourself this morning?
I got up. I'm watching one of my buddy's dogs, or I guess there's two of them. So I fed those, got up at 8 or something. Then I went out and worked in the terrible hot sun. I'm building something for the yaks out there, and after 2 hours, it just got too hot, and I came back inside and ate, and now we're here.
All right, so we teased the yak thing, and I'm sorry for having a hard time pronouncing your podcast properly, anarcho yakitalvist. It's like, I don't know if you this is before your time. There's a thing called ska. Have you ever heard of this?
I have.
Ska.
Yeah, it's the
Okay.
big genre.
Yeah, music. It's like between punk and like reggae, maybe, I guess. So anyway, so they had a tradition in the ska culture. I say they, like, I don't know, collectivizing everyone there, but including myself. The bands had a culture of naming themselves things where you could like take other words that sounded like the word ska, or like one of the syllables had like ska in it, and then they'd like add, make it ska. Like it'd be like, oh shoot, I'm like trying to blank on one. Like it'd be like the Scatolite. There was like Skank and Pickle. I don't know. There's a lot of ska bands that did that kind of stuff. But anyway, probably no one knows what the hell I was just referencing. So do you podcast about just like the creature, the yak, or is it obviously more than that?
I podcast about a lot. I cover almost everything, but philosophy to farming. I have some interviews that are interesting on there. But yeah, some of the farming podcasts are about yaks. I haven't found anybody to do interviews about yaks because I'm definitely not an expert on yaks myself. I've only been doing it for a year. But yeah.
All right. I want to get more into the yak thing later, but I think what maybe you might be more known for, like at least in online circles, other than like your farming and yak background, is your like podcasting personality and presence, I guess you could say. So which came first? Was it your presence on the Freedom Fiends or was it your own personal podcast? How did that go?
Well, so I called into the Freedom Fiends back when Michael Dean was doing Michael Dean After Dark. I called into that, and he helped me set up the podcast. And then eventually, not too soon after I made the show, he invited me to do some third wheel co-hosting, and I've moved up since. I don't know when the first time I did Freedom Feens was, though. It was back in August. So it was like right along at the same time.
Right, right. So I think I've heard that story before that you like might have told on the Feens before. Or I'm sure you did, but like, was it, what drove your interest into like going into podcasting? Was it just a coincidence or did you have an actual like intention to become and like get into broadcasting?
So I've always wanted to do some sort of thing. There aren't a lot of ANCAPs around here, so it's hard to do some activism. And, I wanted to do something for, you know, doing the Liberty movement, And I didn't really know exactly what to do. And then Michael Dean gave me the opportunity to do podcasting. I was like, damn, got to do it.
Sweet. So you're just basically an opportunist. Yeah. You know?
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, that's not bad. Could be worse things to be called, I guess. So do you see broadcasting like in the radio or vocal medium as your final like, are you happy with that? Or do you think you're going to get into video or get into like, you know, real life activism or making documentaries? Like, is there anything else you're curious about? Or are you just kind of just going with it?
I'm kind of going with it, but, I do like podcasting. I do like radio. I prefer that over, doing videos because it's so much easier to edit.
Yeah.
But eventually I would like to do a documentary. I've been working with a few buddies and we're into, you know, trying to make movies. Nobody's really too motivated on that front, so it's gonna be a while if we ever do anything, but I'd like to do a documentary on what I've done with the farm.
I was gonna say, would the movie be yak inspired in any way?
yes it will.
Nice. So I guess that begs the question, let's jump into the yak thing. We to tease the I guess like the main topic possibly we hubbub like about a week ago before some crazy white boy shot up a church and a couple crazy laws were passed. But we will get to the flat tax, but let's start on yaks.
Okay.
So any reason in particular you chose the yak to start with? I mean, I personally know of like a lot of different types of creatures, from donkeys to goats to sheep to what's that baby llama thing? Alpaca. Those are supposedly really affordable, and you know the wool could be used for yarn and everything else. And what was it about the yak that spoke to you?
Well, so I live in really rural part of Oregon. It was like Polk County, or one of the most rural ones in the Willamette Valley, at least Eastern Oregon's. Got four people in it, but I have a lot of family that raises cattle. Everybody around here has at least a little bit of land. If anybody that does have land is raising some cattle on it. And I wanted to get into agriculture because I decided I hated school. That was a way to get out. And I didn't want to raise cattle because I'm like, oh, that's boring. Everybody does that. And so I have no idea how I came up with this. I decided to look into yaks. I was like, wow, I'm going to look into yaks and see what those things are. And I don't know how exactly that got started, but I looked them up, found that there were actually some people here in Oregon raising them. And they're actually pretty awesome and amazing animals. So I was like, wow, I got to do this. So I got a couple. And then now we're here with 11 of them out there.
What are the yaks? I mean, obviously you're investing in the yaks. I'd imagine some sort of, you know, business purpose, or I'm sure hobby or you do for some sort of personal gain. That's maybe a bold assumption, but is there anything the yaks provide you other than friendship and warmth if you all hurdle together? I mean, what do you do with the yaks? Do you have yak eggs that you sell, or how does that work?
So the main plan, this is my career plan, is to have the first commercial yak dairy in the United States. And there's only places that have commercial yak dairies are in Asia, in China, Tibet, Mongolia, and Nepal. So nobody is selling a whole lot of milk here. There might be a few small people who are doing it off the farm, selling raw milk, but nobody's really doing it on a larger scale. So I'd like to do that. I'd like to get some milk from them, and that'll take a little while. Well, we're working on the thing that I was building this morning is a way to capture them so that I can start handling them to get them used to being milked. So that's the main thing. And then I'm also trying to get some. I'll be butchering a few this next month, and they have decent meat. It tastes a lot like beef, a little bit leaner. And then also the hair. They've got like exquisite hair. It's fantastic. People who are into fiber love it. It's an amazing wool, and we'll be getting some of that too.
Yeah. My friends know I don't have any youth in arms reach. I thought I did. I'm a bit of a wool man myself. I like to throw down a little knit or crochet once in a while, a little hacky sack, hat, scarf. So I could take some yak fur and go to town with that.
Yeah, you should try and find some. It's expensive. It's really
I'm sure.
But it's quality.
Yeah. Okay. All right. So that's a good thing with isn't that gonna put you up against the same hurdles that regular cow milk manufacturers face of having to pasteurize the milk?
So actually it's interesting because yaks, I have to look into some of the loopholes with this, but yaks aren't, I'm not sure if yaks are included as cattle. So there are different regulations for goats compared to the cattle. So I'm wondering, goats have more lax regulations than cows do. So I'm going to see how yaks are defined by the USDA and see if I can get them separate or if I can argue that they're, you know, entirely different animal or that they're actually a goat. So we'll see if we can pull some little loophole magic and do some stuff. But yeah, normally I would be having to follow the regulations that the USDA and FDA put on dairies, which will be frustrating.
Blah, blah, blah. Yeah, yeah, it's a bunch of crap. That's all right. You know what? It's sort of like, I feel like it's a neutral proposition in the sense that when the state collapses, let's say it was any arbitrary time in the future, let's just say 2 years from now, at that point in 2 years from now, we'd have many benefits immediately from the state collapsing. We'd have many, I guess, at least short-term, medium-term downsides to it, so to speak, maybe just the interim between the new spontaneous order and the old course of order and what that would look like. But you're still young, right? And I'm going to transition to a different topic. You're still young. Tell everyone how old you are in case that was in the part where you were glitching and I couldn't hear you. And what are you in school? What grade? And is it true that you're thinking about dropping out?
Okay, I lost you there for a second, but I think you asked about dropping out. Is that right?
Yeah, I asked how old you are, what grade you're in, and if it's true you're thinking about dropping out.
Okay, I'm 16. I'll be turning 17 in August. I just finished my last year in school. I did drop out. I just finished my sophomore year, and I am officially no longer enrolled in school, in public school or anything. So I'm going to be doing some self-education stuff, which is super exciting.
Congratulations. Thank you. Yeah, I wish I had the foresight to make those type of choices in my own life at the time. I was part of the 2002 graduating class in my high school. And then I went on to spend about 5 years at college on my dad's dime, basically co-signing student loans that he went and paid off with his inheritance, which comes out of my inheritance, so to speak, theoretically, which I think what I ended up doing after college was spend a few years selling cars, and that's where I made some money and learned my business savvy and learned to appreciate the free market. But I missed the good time of the car industry. I got started in 2008. Had I not gone to college for 5 years, had I just went into sales, I would have been there when the newcomers were making $80,000 a year with their eyes closed. And you'd be looking at a different guy now. I probably would be in a camper. So college set me back, I would say, just rough numbers, probably in the ballpark of about $500,000.
Wow.
So, yeah, I don't know how much high school cost me, probably, you know, something. But, yeah, man, spending your time working with your hands, learning things, studying, auto-didacting your way to knowledge. that's not correct usage, but some of you guys know what I'm talking about. Sorry if you can't hear me. I'm a little glitchy right now.
Yeah, I dropped out a couple times there.
Ha ha ha. Okay.
That was not.
I want to ask. I want to ask you about the dropping out thing, just to wrap that up. Dropping out of school. We don't want to preach to the choir too much. To anyone stumbling across this video on YouTube who doesn't think of dropping out of high school as this thing worth congratulating, what were your motives for dropping out, and how are you so sure it's going to work out for you?
There are a few motivating factors. Last year is when I decided that I had to get out of school. That's right when I started working with the yaks and my pigs, doing some farm stuff, and I realized that I didn't like it there. I had a lot of just issues. I can't stay in a classroom and sit down. It's just too stressful. And there was it's a difficult school that I was going to, like the 44th most rigorous school in the nation, determined by Huffington Post or something. So it was difficult, and I was doing well. I had a 4.0 freshman year. Considerably dropped this last semester because I failed a few classes because I was just done. It was not what I wanted to do. I didn't enjoy it. I was learning on my own, the podcast and stuff. I mean, I was already learning, and I'm way ahead of my peers on a lot of stuff. You know, I can get up and talk to you about the flat tax systems and whatever. Well, nobody would know what I was talking about back at school. I think that I was ahead of my peers. I think I'm learning on my own. School was just not worth it. I've got a good business idea with the yaks. I think that it's more enjoyable, right? I'm having fun doing what I'm doing at school. I was bored and stressed out. It was just terrible. My big main motivating factors is it's a waste of time, and I like the yaks more.
Well, I think I certainly wouldn't have anything to say to go against that. As a personal advocate of live and let live type of viewpoint, I was talking to another person off of the record who might be publishing some content on my channel about trying to understand individual liberty and understand a society that is beyond government, but without expecting everyone to just magically adhere to the NAP or magically adhere to property rights, which I think is a valid concern. So in that process, I realized that like there are so many perspectives out there, and that like simply just doing this, simply just us connecting on some ideas, you have a bit of a following, I'm sure, through the Feens, and I have a bit of a following through my channel. Just to make sure that everyone knows everyone here, that alone is what we're spending our time here to do. And the rest is kind of window dressing to get people in the door, kind of, right?
Sure.
Not to speak for you, but I feel like we're both here to just kind of make more awareness around individual liberty.
Absolutely. I think that's one of the main things. And I'm disappointed that I haven't been able to do a lot of that on my own show, but we're getting there.
Yeah. It's my pleasure, dude. You're the fourth Fiend. So
nice.
I want to get your take on that. Like, how much of your experience of liberty is about the philosophy and the doctrine and all that of the NAP and property rights and Rothbard and Mises, and how much it is just you not wanting to be bugged and wanting to be left alone? Like, how much do you really get into the theory stuff?
So I started out in politics. I've always been interested in politics since I was like 14, maybe 12, actually. I got introduced into libertarianism at a very young age. Family on my dad's side, the Hazeltons, have always been kind of extremely right-wing Tea Party, and more libertarian than the Tea Party kind of people. And my dad was a little bit less of a conservative, and he voted libertarian in the 2008 candidate, whatever. But that's how I got introduced to that. Yes, I got stuck in the middle between McCain and Obama. And I was like, I don't want to choose between these people. That upset one of my friends and you know, whatever. But my dad said he's voted for Bob Barr. So that was my way to be in the middle. I got into libertarianism like that, just as a weird thing to try and keep my friends happy. And then I started getting into it. I started listening to stuff that was going on. And I was like, well, yeah, the libertarians do make sense. And so I started getting into that, eventually found the Freedom Feens. And politics has always been something fun for me. And when I started listening to the Freedom Feens, I was like, okay, maybe some of this makes sense. And maybe it'd be great to have an anarcho-capitalist system, and we don't need the government. And then I started getting into it even more. Yeah, I do spend a lot of time theorizing. I don't consider myself as strict of a believer in the non-aggression principle as many anarcho-capitalists are. I identify as a utilitarian when it comes to politics, rather than I don't know what you call it, but I do follow the non-aggression principle. I believe that it's a doctrine that would benefit the world if people followed it. I think that when you look logically at how things are made up in this world, if you work your way through the philosophical branches, which is where I spend most of my time, is in ethics and studying really deep philosophy. I think if you look through all those branches of philosophy that, you know, Ayn Rand espouses in objectivism, the non-aggression principle is a logical conclusion. That's my long way of explaining that. Sorry. But
no, that's all right. I think when we talk about libertarian ethics and I guess the culture of libertarianism, one of the, you know, many sacred cows is the NAP. And it's understandable that myself and yourself and many others might be a little hesitant to try to, you know, slaughter that cow. But we also want to be able to defend our views as best as possible. And while it is possible to work around ways to, not work around, but, you know, come up with possibly quite legitimate ways to justify your discussion, it's not conclusive, right? It's still an argument for, it's you know, it's the, I guess it's not science. I don't know how else to put it. So we can't trust people to necessarily just walk through the woods onto our property with the same set of ethics that we have. So sure. It is interesting to be aware that people can have a similar perspective, like, hey, I don't want government, or hey, I don't want to be aggressed upon by anybody. But I guess part of the fear is, I guess, that the cookie starts to unravel when you take out the NAP or you take out property rights. And that's why I think you see ANCAPs and ANCOMs, you know, going at it so strongly, because property rights or, you know, NAP seems to be so essential to ending the state. Do you see the state ending? Do you think that it's something that people can get together on in the future? Or is it an ideal that is just a scholarly activity?
I go back and forth on this sometimes, I would consider myself, at the end of the state. Okay. I go back and forth on it a bit. But I consider myself an optimist, and I definitely see it as a possibility, maybe not in the near future, but certainly, further along. I think that libertarian ideas are making ground. I think that we're really making progress. It's not, maybe not a whole lot of progress, but it's a small movement, and we are gaining some traction. And I think that libertarians are, you know, at least the minarchist libertarians are now being recognized.
Now being
very little bit in the mainstream.
Very little bit,
especially with the help of Ron Paul. I don't consider Rand Paul much of a libertarian, but I think that he does. He at least gets publicity and shows that there are people with that kind of mindset. And I think that we are making headway like that. And it's going to be a very long road. I don't think I'll ever see the collapse of the state, but I do think it'll happen. And I think that when you work from any ideological background, almost always you can trace it back to the principles of just straight up anarchy, like no rulers. It's hard to really argue against that point, I think, when you get down to it.
Well, I mean, you and I probably have some amount of experience trying to do so. And I think it is, you know, I think it is pretty self-evident to people who get it. But at the same time, I think the fear of survival for people, especially who are from the city or from more comfortable confines, like, you're a nature boy. I've done my fair share of traveling. I've camped in the woods enough nights to realize it's not all as scary as people crack it up to be sometimes, like the real world, so to speak. But then again, it does have its parts you got to watch out for. But I think that you might be a little, I'll say, pessimistic, perhaps. Really? I just think that financially, like, yeah, I think the cookie's going to crumble, and the only way they're going to be able to save their ass is to go to some sort of new world currency or whatever. And if they usher that in, maybe even knows. But I certainly don't know how well I'm going to feel about living in a world that's subsumed under one big world government. You know, like, that would definitely bug me out.
Yeah, so I've actually heard that point a few times.
And I think it's interesting.
I don't know enough about economics to say the state's going to close anytime soon. And you know, if it does, then that's absolutely awesome.
Yeah, I mean, so the idea is like, you understand supply and demand, but I'm going to make a simple analogy for the audience in case they don't really gut check get it. You're at a birthday party and there's going to be 20 people there. So you get a cake big enough for 20 people to have a slice. You're cutting the cake and half of it falls on the ground. Half the cake is screwed. So for everyone to get a slice now, everyone's got to have half. That's the idea of a zero sum game, meaning there's only so many pieces of cake to go around and there's so many mouths. So you just do the math. It's a naive perspective to think that this is how supply and demand works, but it's not, I guess it's not terribly misguided insofar as quantity of availability of resources is the relevant factor. So if you had 100 yaks, you'd be thinking something different than if you have 10 yaks in terms of your plans, in terms of your assets, in terms of your risks you might take. So it's relevant to keep track of our assets and to keep track of the relative supply that we have control over versus the market, versus our competitors, versus our peers. But when it comes to something that's a currency, which the economists that are informing me have convinced me that the economy might be on its last legs, is for the same reason that we saw such a sharp market crash in 2008 and banks collapsed. And supposedly, like, there's movies about this where, you know, a bunch of the bigwigs got in a room and said, hey, we have like 24 hours to fix this thing from completely falling apart. Because as much as it's all rigged, probably to some degree, there's individuals at play here. And the guy that owns XYZ Bank can fold his hand before he's really supposed to or whatever and sell it to XYZ Bank or ZBA Bank or whatever, you know what I mean? And then show the hand of bankers that, oh, this is going to crumble. And then so there's kind of like an orderly, like, musical chairs game taking place of how each entity is supposed to act. But it's too much for any mind, I think, to process with certainty. But again, just starting with basic principles, if you add dollars like crazy to our world, it has to go somewhere. Either everyone saves, which should incentivize lending, which should raise interest rates, which would screw up the Federal Reserve, the ability to pay back the Federal Reserve, or, you know, the prices go up because there's so many dollars that, you know, merchants need to get more in order to invest more in capital goods, or, you know, it just creates stagnation. So, you know, dude, trust me when I tell you, I don't have a classical understanding of this stuff either, but if Peter Schiff, if Jeff Berwick, if, you know, Jared Salenti, if Ron Paul, if these more enlightened minds can put it as eloquently as they do, and we can not suss out anything suspect with their logic, you know, I could just put a bunch of links in the description here, but you're a young man, and I don't want to convince you per se that the market's going to cause the government to go away or collapse. But I guess just as saying, like, you know, I'm almost twice your age, or I'm twice your age actually, and give or take, I'm hopeful to see it not just in my lifetime, but like in the next decade. Like, I'd love to see just basically a worldwide anarchy where everyone's like, "Oh my God, what are we doing?" Like, dude, not that like I want us to be gods or leaders or rulers at all, but like, you know, we'd have a little bit of celebrity status even among our friends and family to where they're like, "Oh my God, Nick, you were right." Like, you know what I mean? Like, what do we do now? Like, I don't know, get some medals and some animals.
Yeah. So I think it's interesting. I'll have to do some more research on that. And yeah, well, I'm open to the idea. I'm not going to say yet, no, the government's going to survive it. I don't know. I have no idea. But yeah, it's interesting.
Yeah, I think a lot of it just is, maybe it's preordained. I think it's just filler for the attention being on them in the media and stuff. Like, let's act like we're debating whether or not we're going to bail out Greece every month for like the next 6 months. And then at the end of every month, just bail them out last minute. And we'll use that as a story. You know what I mean? And then after that, we'll let Greece collapse or whatever. Like, you know what I mean? Like, they probably had this figured out for like the next 3 years. Like, oh yeah, okay, Bilderberg, whatever. I'm not trying to get all conspiracy theorists, but like, kids do it. Like, if there's three boys and one girl hanging out in a backyard, they'll probably be up to no good. I don't know. It's my theory. Yeah. I'll take ownership of that.
All right.
But I want to get into the meat and bones here. We did talk about, you know, as long as Google can give us some more awesome broadband bandwidth. I have a few other questions that I might throw at you at the end. But on the flat tax side, before I throw questions at you, tell me what you know about flat tax, because we might not know very much combined about it. But what do you know about flat tax?
Well, so I understand what a flat tax is. It's playing a flat rate instead of a percentage, right? where we have an income tax, you pay a certain percentage of your income. Instead, flat tax would be you pay just this lump sum. That's what I've understood it.
Yeah, see, I think I had a different understanding of it, but maybe it could be both, right? Some of our more critical viewers might be like, these guys are dumb. Change channel, whatever. But I don't care. No, but this is informative, and maybe people can school us, and hey, whatever, I'll learn. I'll be humble. The first time I remember hearing about a flat tax was back in when I was in grade school or so. I forget. Steve Forbes, I believe, was a candidate who was running on the Democratic side who was for a flat tax, and I think what he was saying was something to the neighborhood of it would be flat percentage. So instead of the rich paying, you know, higher and the poor paying less or whatever, it would be no matter what, where you are in society, no matter what your deductions are, no matter you're married or not, you pay 18% of what you make or whatever the percentage was. What you're saying sounds more like a flat amount, like you owe 10 grand a year kind of thing or something like that. Does that sound right? Or
yeah. So I now I think about it, I have more commonly hear that the percentage argument, like Herman Cain's 7-7 plan or 999. I don't remember, but yeah, no, I understand what you're saying.
Do you think it would make a difference, like a flat tax versus what we have now? Do you think it makes a difference? Or do you think one is better than the other?
Yeah, I kind of think that a flat tax would be better. I don't really know. I mean, it's still taxes, and
I mean, it certainly probably would make it more simple, but for whom and at an expense? Is it more simple now for the state to get their money, or is it now more simple for the individual to, or both, like to not have a headache doing your taxes?
Yeah, so that's what I would think. It would be both easier for the government, and it'd be also easier for them to take your money, and be easier for the people to get the money, their money.
That's a concern. That's a valid concern. Another concern I have about the flat tax is basically it might be the same thing restated in a different way, but I don't want to be in favor of anything that's going to make the government more efficient, which is why I wouldn't vote for a libertarian candidate. What are your thoughts on voting, and do you see the link there, like about making the government more efficient?
So I actually had this conversation with somebody who was talking about the collapse of the state, like we were earlier about how, and he's like you, he thinks it's going to crash much sooner than I do. Still arguing from that position where I'm not as optimistic as you guys. I would like to see a slow transition rather than an immediate transition in the stateless society. So I am in favor because I'm skeptical of how damaging a quick transition could be.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not too worried about the transition itself. I hate to sound insensitive, but I'm not even worried about people starving because, like, I'm a cold fuck. No, because I really don't think anyone would. I think, there's opportunists in every market, right? So all the companies in the world all of a sudden wake up one day and realize, we don't get our handouts anymore. We don't get our special legislative protections anymore, but we have to differentiate ourselves in the market. What is Walmart going to now have against the mom and pop store when it's now more expensive for Walmart to get the same goods across the country when road tax and permits and all that stuff can't be prohibitive to the small business and there's no zoning and stuff. So small businesses can just grow their resources locally now without having to import everything and be price competitive with, you know, foreign markets. I mean, I know I'm throwing a lot out there, but can you see how maybe in a collapse of a government that the free market could come in way faster than people think and fill the void?
Yeah.
Or is that wishful thinking?
I'm kind of in the middle there. I feel like as soon as the state collapses, that Portland's got their own thing. You know, we got the state of Jefferson that pops up or whatever, those weirdos down south.
It sounds like you're saying that it would be more logical or more reasonable for you to see it being more of like a process of like individual secessions more and more locally before just a one big collapse kind of scene, or is that right?
Yeah, that's more of what I would expect.
The thing you're referencing in Oregon, is that to do with the movement to split up California in a bunch of states?
Cascading independence. I believe it's related.
All right. So if people want to look into that, they could Google search Cascade Independence and probably find some resources.
I think so. Cascadia Independence.
Oh, Cascadia. Okay, cool.
It's an interesting little movement.
Right. Yeah, I was going to say, I don't know how much more we could really even say about the flat tax thing without just being speculative. No, I just think that a tax is a tax. If people are allowed to steal from some people are allowed to steal, then we're doing it wrong. Does that make sense to you? Do you see it that way at all?
Yeah. So that's why I don't think the flat tax is a good step in the right direction. I don't think it's really would matter a whole lot. It's still, you're still being taxed, and it still sucks, and it's just terrible. So I'm with you on that it's still stealing, and it's still prohibitive and it's a real burden.
Yeah, I mean, I definitely feel like we're preaching to the choir, but yeah. Perhaps in the comments, if we have some statists or to define the word statist and unpack that a little bit, if there's any people watching or listening who would like to defend having centralized monopolies in different parts of society versus having laissez-faire or free market types of spontaneous order, let's get some honest and critical feedback on that to see if we could get better questions asked, better topics, or, you know, help task on these topics. But I think Nick and I are sort of preaching to the choir on this, in that voting is coercive. Nick, I want to end on, aside from Michael Dean and the other Freedom Fiends, and obviously myself, because I'm not looking for a compliment, who in the Liberty Movement are you a fan of? Is there anyone that jumps out at you that you could recommend people to check out?
Yeah, Brett Vinat, School Sucks. School Sucks is definitely the most influential media outlet in my life right now, and it has been for a while. That's definitely the main one.
Wow, yeah, I've listened to a lot of School Sucks podcast. Haven't gotten as into it as I've actually gotten into the Freedom Fiends or Free Talk Live or even Adam Kokesh back when he did Adam versus the Man. But that's just my preference. So do check out School Sucks podcast, everybody. Google search that. Nick, thank you for that. I would like to ask you this question. This is sort of a tricky one. Not a tricky one. Hopefully you can give me something on this one. Sort of dig in here. I personally find there to be a few different distractions or, you know, wasted efforts, maybe in the Liberty Movement, without my naming any of them. Do you see any types of conversations or distractions that are maybe destructive to the?
Yeah, I feel like there's a lot of wasted efforts online. I don't think it's necessary to scream about the non-aggression principle, like taxes and property rights. I've stepped away from that and trying to be compassionate with people. It doesn't help to troll. It doesn't help to bitch about all these different things on Facebook. There is some that do try to learn from those Facebook conversations. So I think that being a dick online is a waste of time, and you really shouldn't do it.
That's good advice. I think I myself had been guilty in the past of coming off a little dickish to some people. Right? You get that like sense of cockiness where it's like, I know what's right. And you're like going to school, everybody.
Yeah. That's the problem.
But then you're part of the problem in a way. You're like a little tyrant. Let's see. I'm going to try to mincemeat this thing in Adobe and see if I can make it a lot more coherent for people to enjoy. Nick, do you have any other thoughts? Anything else you want to say that's on your mind? Anything bothering you at the moment or inspiring you at the moment?
No, I'm, I guess not. No, but I'm having fun. It's fun doing this sort of stuff. I hope to get some more Liberty people on my show, and I would love to have you on when I'm not so much busy with the hacks, but yeah.
I might be moving to PA, actually. My dad's trying to buy this property. I don't really know exactly what the deal is yet, but if I get land, man, I want to try to just get to more sustainable living, like whether I have chickens or, you know, bigger livestock. But yeah, maybe that'll be the time for me to come on when I'm doing my own farming journey.
Yeah, that'd be so exciting. You know? I love that.
Yeah, because I'd be a total noob and I would have a lot of questions. So one trick question kind of at the end, and then I want you to plug everything. If you had to choose between yak farming or podcasting for the rest of your life, which would it be and why?
Oh, I've been thinking about this all the time in the last few months. If I could and I felt like I could make a good living and I thought that I could do do a lot of the stuff that I want to do while podcasting, I would totally do it, and I would drop a yak farm. I'm a little bit worried on how effectively I could monetize my own show. So I'm doing the yak stuff because I love doing it. I love doing the farming, and I do love podcasting a little bit more. But
I'm guessing Google has the answer to that question. I heard you say a lot of it. Yeah, man, I'll have you back on again anyway. I'm not as busy as you are on purpose. Like, I'm in my 30s, and I've been trying my hardest not to have a job as much as possible, doing freelance work and trying to make money off donations and off my website and stuff. So I will have you back, dude. Rock on. Give everyone your web address for your show and for Freedom Fiends so they can find you and whatever else you want to share.
Yeah, so my podcast is at an-yak.com. It's an-yak.com. You can find us on iTunes, Stitcher, and TuneIn. The Freedom Fiends is Freedom Fiends. .com. That's freedom, FEENS.com. And you can also find them on iTunes, Stitcher, and TuneIn. And whenever we're on the radio, I don't remember what.
I want to let the audience know that this program is covered by a BIPCOT.gov license, which you can find out more about at BIPCOT.org. Basically, that means actually, Nick, why don't you tell the audience? You're a little more practiced. What does BIPCOT.gov license mean?
It means, I believe, I actually don't know much about this. My podcast is not licensed with it because I want the government to use my stuff. But it means that anybody can use it except the government.
That's correct. Yeah, man. I just like it because it's like a, I think MWD, Michael W. Dean, intends it this same way, but I'm not going to put words in his mouth. It's a bit of a hoax, I feel like, on the state. Like it's a joke on IP in my mind, but.
Yeah, it is. I love it.
It's cool. We take it very seriously here at Rose Liberty. Cool. So you guys can go to bipcot.org and find out more about that and license your own media on that platform to keep it out of the grubby hands of government and basking in freedom forever time. Nick, thanks again for coming on the program. Go and enjoy your liberty, my friend.
Yeah, same to you. Thanks for having me on.
All right, cool, man. Over and out. Till next time.